Give us grace to follow your saints of old godly living. Heal us in the one true faith, that together with all your saints, we may sing your praises in heaven.
We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
He lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you, Bill, for reading us ancient words of Job. We don't know exactly where Job lived, but yeah, come on up.
Is this me?
Yeah, you're the guy, aren't you?
First I heard of
it. Prior email.
That's true. Bill had an eye for it, isn't that? Can you do it? First time I've looked at it. Like I said, we think Job was even before Abraham. So these words are like 2,000 years before Jesus. Beautiful ancient hope that is ours. That is it. That's correct, Bill.
Let there be light. All right, this is from Job 19. Oh, that my words were recorded, that they were written on a scroll, that they were inscribed with an iron tool on lead, or engraved in rock forever. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
The New Testament reading is from Philippians 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Not rehearsed. Thank you, Bill. Let's stand as we rejoice to hear good news from our Lord Jesus. Speaking to us here at the start of the Sermon on the Mount on page 4, you see we're reading responsively. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountain and sat down. His disciples came to him, and Jesus began to teach them. Blessed are those who recognize they are spiritually helpless.
The kingdom of heaven belongs to them.
Blessed are those who mourn.
They will be comforted.
Blessed are those who are gentle.
They will inherit the earth.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God's approval.
They will be satisfied.
Blessed are those who show mercy.
They will be treated mercifully.
Blessed are those whose thoughts are pure.
They will see God.
Blessed are those who make peace. Blessed are those who are persecuted for doing what God approves of.
The kingdom of heaven belongs to them.
Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, lie, and say all kinds of evil things about you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because you have a great reward in heaven. The prophets who lived before you were persecuted in these ways. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated, friend. So I have a lot of kids on board for sharing the message today. No, we're going to do a shot today. We got guest kids today. All right. Little Tegan's here too, a little young for me, though. Well, so last Sunday we had our big celebration. We called it Reformation, and what was the number?
500.
500 years since those 95 theses. And we decided it's still all about Jesus.
Right.
So today, another grand celebration. We call it All Saints, and what number would we give it? Actually, it goes way back before those days of the Reformation, doesn't it? We could call this one, actually, if we wanted to, All Saints 1800. It was only about 200 years after Jesus rose from the dead that Christians started gathering in worship, you know, part of their regular weekend worship. They would gather then once a year also to remember the believers who had walked in the faith with them and those in the generations before. They just have been examples of what it means to live following Jesus. So All Saints 1800, it's still all about Jesus, but with All Saints, it's all about then also the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Think about that. The way our marvelous Trinity, the three-in-one God, works. If I tell you about God the Father, I'm going to tell you about what does he do. You think of the Father, what's his central work? What do you think? Yeah, he's the creator, right? That's why we call him Father, the maker of all things, right? And if I talk about Jesus, what do we think of him as doing? The Son of God. What does he do for us? He's the rescuer, the one who was crucified and laid down our life for us. So the Father, the Son, we've got a very clear picture of their marvelous work in our lives. And the Holy Spirit, what does he do for us? Yeah, some people are grabbing their heart there. It's in the heart, isn't it? It's a little more nebulous, I think. The work of the Spirit. So when the Creed talks about it, it says, I believe in the Holy Spirit. What does he do? The first thing it says, the Holy Christian Church. Well, any group of people, a church that's gathered around Christ, of course, is Christian. But why does the Creed say Holy Christian Church? My dad used to joke, we say in the Creed, I believe in the Holy Christian Church, because we've never seen one yet. But the Creed seems to press on this point. Because after it says, Holy Spirit, Holy Christian Church, then it says, the communion of saints. Who's it talking about? You know what a communion is. What's a communion? A gathering, a communion, a community. Those who God gathers to his communion to here are his community, right?
Yeah.
A communion of saints? Would you like to be a part of a church where everybody is holy and perfect? Wow. What is it talking about here? So when you're out in the world this past week doing whatever God gives you to do, did you find yourself saying, oh, well, that person must be a Christian. I can tell because they're so different, holy and perfect than anybody else. And so as you look through your day, you can tell the Christians from the non-Christians. Is that right? Probably not. We had a fabulous week here at Concordia, so a lot of people are looking maybe a little bit tired, but then got an extra hour of sleep. Because the last couple of days, Concordia was really hard, even more than that, right? Setting up. We had our great rummage sale, which is a wonderful opportunity for us to share some love with the neighborhood. And we have fun working together and get to even invite folks to be part of our worshiping community. So that was a lot of fun. And as we were doing that rummage sale all week, we all went away from that saying, and now I didn't even have any trouble with anybody. In fact, I myself was perfectly holy and perfect towards everybody I dealt with. Right? No, probably not. You know, even at church, we sometimes have a little friction, right? What is the Creed talking about? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the community of saints. How do they get to be that? What's the next part? The forgiveness of sins. There's the secret sauce. That's what this is all about. It's all about Jesus and the great gift that the Spirit
Spirit has for us, pushing that on our hearts. The amazing forgiveness of God. So in fact, as God looks at us, we are a community of saints. He says, oh, these are my perfect people. They're washed clean by Jesus. These are the people who are learning more and more how to even live in that holiness by the great gift of my Spirit. Because they're set free of their sin, they're fearless. And now they can begin to live with that love that I have given to them. And that's not even the end of the story, that we're working towards being more saintly because of the great gift of God in us. In fact, we know how the story ends. Christian church, forgiveness of sins, and then what? The resurrection of the body. And that very only the start of what God's plan finally amounts to. Life everlasting. Oh, I forgot to put my picture up. So 2.5 years ago, we got out to Los Angeles on vacation. And if you ever get out there, you've got to see the cathedral. Maybe you're like me, you've seen cathedrals all over the world, and I love to visit them. In fact, we take what we call the ABC tour, another blasted cathedral. Right? We love to visit cathedrals. But this one in Los Angeles is so beautiful. It was only built in the year 2002, so it's different from any other cathedral I ever saw. It's like a modernist box, and yet it works so perfectly as a worship space. And along the walls of this giant cathedral, going down both sides, we've got these beautiful tapestries. I think there's more than 15 on each wall. I've got little pieces of three of them. And it's all these saints, holy people through the centuries, 135 of them. Well-known people like, here we've got, you know, Peter with his ready to write his epistles, and there's Paul, his cross upside down. I got that backwards. Paul with the epistles and Peter with the cross upside down. But I mean famous people. You know, we don't talk much about Moses of Ethiopia, one of these great saints of the Middle Ages. Different cultures, different genders, different ages. And it's really wonderful to be there as all these people and all the people in worship there are all facing one direction, and they're all looking towards what? So behind the altar, there's a glorious giant window with this big cross, the beautiful California sun shining in. And you just like, it's glorious. It's this wondrous cross. Like, that's how they got to be saints, you know? They believe in forgiveness, and they're marching on towards that with us, this great cloud of believers before us. When we talk this morning about All Saints Day, we're not just talking about perfect people before us. There were none. We're talking about people like us. In fact, we're talking about the people with us. The great saints in your life are the ones who led you to Jesus. It's all about Jesus. And those people had the gift of the Spirit in their lives where they knew how to talk to you and how to lead you also to Jesus. And guess what? You get to be a saint as you too, grasping forgiveness, perfect and pure before God. You get to help people turn towards that cross, to walk towards Him who makes us holy. So I just give God thanks for the great people that I get to work with in Concordia, the wondrous people that have been in my life, some of whom have gone home. You know, the saints around me and the history of the saints before that encouraged me in the faith. I'm going to do something very different this morning. And then I want to share with you something very personal. You know, my eldest son, Ben, lives up in Philadelphia, married to Michelle 7 years ago. Great job. The kid works as a National Service Park Ranger right there at the Liberty Bell in Philadelphia, sometimes at Independence Hall. So a great guy in my life. And many of you have been asking me about the sad news. I have been honored so many times to walk with you people in your lives. I mean, many of you. We've had great joys together, weddings and babies and all kinds of great stuff in our lives. And we've walked through some hard times together, you know, some illness and even death in that dark valley. So I have to not be shy, but also share with you my life. And I'm going to do this with words from Ben. And that's really the reason I'm doing this, because I just can't talk to you about it 100 times everybody's going. But Ben wrote this thing that really spoke to my heart, and I believe it will be a blessing to you also. So I asked my son if I could share. He wrote this note to friends of his, and I asked him if I could share it with Concordia friends, and he said, please. So here's my son's words. The Tuesday before last, so is that 12 days ago, Michelle and I were informed by a doctor that the child she was carrying had developed a devastating, untreatable, unswervingly fatal birth defect. Sunday night, a week ago, Michelle went into labor 4 months prematurely. The delivery was mercifully short and uncomplicated. Michelle gave birth to a baby boy at 6:38 in the morning on Monday, October 30. He weighed 1 pound even, was 11 inches tall. Despite the severity of his birth defect and the earliness of his delivery, he somehow lived for an hour and 20 minutes after birth. Even if he had been carried to term, he would not have been able to live much longer than that. I can state with confidence that at no point did our son experience any pain or suffering. Outside of that part of his body affected by this birth defect, he was perfectly formed. My Ellen did get to hold him up there. Ben says, our pastor baptized him. Pastor Fritz, God bless him, was right there with him the whole time. I held him in my hand as he died, says Ben, and Michelle held his hand. This was hard, but it was good. Good. I've been blessed in 4 ways. The sun rose as my son died, and when all the commotion was over, I looked out the window at the skyline and at the people in the street below, and my friends, I tell you, the world had never looked so beautiful to me before. After seeing something go so terribly wrong, I marveled at how much goes right, how fundamentally good this world is that God has created. Those construction workers placing I-beams, the medevac helicopters landing overhead, the people queuing at Philadelphia's bus stop, the neighborhood kids playing on their porches when I got home, all of this struck me as so wondrous as to be almost miraculous. The second blessing has been the care of the medical professionals who helped us from the beginning. And here Ben talked about the general practitioner, the obstetrician, these hospital doctors, and how kind, empathetic, warm they were. The two nurses in the delivery room were really the most incredible. They were exceptionally skilled and kind and gentle. They responded with heroic courage to a situation that most would have found terrifying. They were unfailingly professional, but they were not professionally detached. It would have been easier for them to mentally distance themselves from what was happening, but they chose to grieve with us and to treat our poor son with dignity, compassion, and love. We will literally never forget those nurses. The third blessing, my wife. I've never been so desperately in need of her as I was this past week. The burden she bore was heavier than mine, and yet she shouldered it and helped me with mine tremendously. My marriage has never been stronger and more sustaining. This is agonizing, but I am in it with her. How many times have you seen that? Trouble, and God builds you up with somebody else, right? The fourth blessing has been my son. He could have died before he was born, but he did not. I got to see him with my own eyes while his heart was still beating. I wish he could have lived for 100 years. I wish I could have seen the things he would have accomplished if this terrible deformity had not happened to him. I wish that the day had not come when my heart would beat and his would not. I have been denied those things. But I got to hold him in my hand for an hour of my life, the greatest privilege of my lifetime. I swear by all the stars in the sky that my son was the most beautiful baby boy. I will never understand how such a scrawny, anemic grunt like me could father such a handsome, yet strong, young son. I remember that feeling myself. Before he was born, Michelle and I named him Isaac Herman Eckert. I would like to explain his name. Unlike my son, I was not privileged to be born with the name Eckert. He was a miracle kid, right? The Eckerts are the kindest, gentlest, godliest people I have ever known, and I am snappish, cynical, and entirely unworthy of their name. Yet it was an honor to adopt my wife's name when I married her, and an even greater honor to have a son who would bear this same Eckert name. Herman is, admittedly, a very goofy name to give to a child, especially one born so tragically. But this was my grandfather's middle name, and he was inordinately proud of it in his right way. My grandfather died 4 years ago of pancreatic cancer on October 30, the same day that my son was born and died. So when my grandfather was sick and knew he was dying, even then he teased me. "Ben, if you ever have a son, would you give him the name Herman as a middle name?" So I have kept that promise to Earl Herman Gaulke, and now my grandfather is with his great-grandson. Earl always loved the babies. My son's first name is Isaac, because he was everything to me and Michelle that the first Isaac was to Abraham and Sarah. So you've got to remember that story. Isaac was our son, our only son, whom we loved. He was a sacrifice that God asked of us against our will. But by faith, Michelle and I, like Abraham, were able to consider the fact that God is able even to raise our son from the dead. Michelle and I worship a God who has known the loss of his only son. We believe in a God who can heal the profoundest injuries and defects. We believe in a God who rescues from the grave. The rest of our lives will be a prelude to that day when we hold our son Isaac again. And then Ben says, quoting Job, "Oh, that my words were written down, oh, that they were inscribed in a book, oh, that with an iron pen and with blood they were engraved on a rock forever, for I know that my Redeemer..." Somebody's got to write it down. Imagine that, more than 2,000 years before Jesus. "I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he shall stand upon the earth, and even after my skin has thus been destroyed, then in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see on my side, and with my own eyes I shall behold him. How my heart faints within me." Lord Jesus, we give you great thanks and praise. You, the resurrected one. You, the forgiver. We give you thanks and praise for the people with whom you surround us in our lives. Those whom you have called and claimed to be your saints and share the faith with us. And also, Lord, those who do not yet know you, and with whom we can share the forgiveness that so changes us. Be, Lord, with all those who are grieving. Be the heart of all of our joy. Come and care for us. And through us, Lord, as your saints, through us, care for one another. We pray in your holy name, to your glory, Lord of the saints. Your name, Jesus. God bless you too, friends, as you share that faith God has given you. Amen. couple of prayer requests this morning. I'm going to pray for Carol, Richard's husband, Richard's wife. Richard was his husband. Carol got a gas on her leg yesterday. It was at the emergency room. She's out of home now. Resting up. She's got a leg up. She's always got a leg up on your head. Our friend Denise Scott here has a heart procedure scheduled for Friday. I want to pray for the Lord's care and healing for Denise. Our dear friend Betsy, 29. Happy birthday, Betsy. We're not telling any lies in church. We're just celebrating the birthday. We're all good. Every year is a good thing. Very happy birthday to you, Betsy. We got one to your head. Please.
For Marcia, she fell Sunday night after a swimming trip. So.
Oh, boy.
But
we
are. She goes to the dentist's job. She's got some work that's
going to happen. Okay, so Lord's care is for Marcia. Logan Moose, that's a mom for Deanne and for Dawn. Other please. Right, yeah, Stephanie just moved down here and having trouble finding the right house. I also have a prayer request for Crystal, for Ken and Diane Warren's daughter, for healing her life. Are there other special prayers in your hearts, please?
For Tammy and Andrew's, Tammy's brother was shot last week.
Oh, my goodness.
So just comfort for them.
Okay, do you know the name of the victim?
I believe it's Don.
Don? Don, Tammy's brother. Healing and care around that situation. Oh, yeah, please, Carol. I'm going to have you turn in this bulletin again to page 6, just before the middle. And stand with me. All Saints Day is our chance to commemorate those. The faithful part, page 6. With God's people throughout His church, we remember on this day all these sinners whom Jesus summoned to Himself in faith and by His forgiveness made His saints. We were created by God to offer Him praise forever. We were redeemed by Jesus, God's Son. We were filled with the Holy Spirit through baptism, where God gave to us eternal life. And we have been nourished in the company of His people through the Lord's Supper and God's good work. Let us then give thanks for those He has called home during the days of this last year. He has summoned them out of His church here at Spiritual Warfare up to His church triumphant above, that they might continue in joyful service to Him forever. James Bartness, Barbara Schaefer, Kathleen Brunson, Randy Eckenberg, Herman Wilson, Jack Miller, Barbara Meadows, and George Delacat. Let us give God our thanks. For even as their bodies rest in the earth, their spirits today enjoy that heavenly crown God gave to them in baptism.
The Lord will come from heaven with a command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the dead believed in Christ, the Lamb of God. Then is there.
expectation for the resurrection of the body to life, we remember before you, O Lord, all those who have gone before us in faith, whom we now pause to name in our hearts. We do thank you for the gift of faith, and we hold fast to the certainty of your promises. May their memory among us be blessed. May we follow in their footsteps of faith to your eternal presence in the heavenly kingdom. Blessed are they that die in the Lord from now on, for they will rest from their labors, and their deeds will follow them. Amen. Blessed Lord, you have chosen to bless us. We do not deserve this. May we live out your blessing in every way and be a blessing to others.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God.
Lord, when we are at the end of our rope and we realize that we cannot rely on ourselves, even then, you bless us. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with your gracious rule in our hearts.
Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be
comforted. Lord, when we experience grief, the death of dear ones, the loss of our dreams, when we are disappointed and discouraged, still, you are with us. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with your comfort.
Blessed are ye, for they will inherit the earth.
Lord God, when you give to us the gift of being humble, modest, content with who we are and what we have, have we yet pridefully rebelled? Still, we are rescued by Christ. We inherit what we need. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with meekness.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled.
Lord, you have blessed us, but we find no satisfaction in the things of this world. Let us feel full of nothing less than your joy, peace, love, righteousness. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with a thirst for you.
Blessed are the merciful.
Lord, you have blessed us with the desire, the ability to care for one another. Show your mercy, Lord Jesus, especially to Anita, Bernice, Diane, Graham, Bill, Carol, Marguerite, to Denise, Carol, Marsha, Lucas, Crystal, Don, Sharon. Be with Stephanie in her. Search for the home you have prepared for her here. Be with Bill and Chris grieving her father, Michelle and Ben, their son, Clayton and Jan grieving his sister. Care for those we name in our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with your mercy.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God.
Lord, you have blessed us with your cleansing forgiveness. Stop our wallowing in guilt and impurities. Every day still more, open our eyes clearly to see you. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with pure hearts.
Blessed are peacemakers, for they will be called children of God.
Lord, you have blessed us with that peace that the world cannot give. Let us, as your sons and daughters, share your peace with the troubled. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us with the heart to make peace.
Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Lord, can we be blessed when we are persecuted? When our deep love for you causes us to be hated by our world, through adversity and pain, drive us even deeper into your kingdom. Make us ever more dependent on you. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us even through persecution.
Blessed is the Lord Jesus, we rejoice and are glad in the blessing you give. We praise you in your name. Amen.
May the Lord be with you all.
May the Lord be with you.
Hearts and hands and voices raised.
Lift us to the Lord in your grace.
Thank you, Lord, our God most good,
for our souls most precious.
It is our duty and delight to give thanks to you, Lord, at all times and in all places. For you are the Holy Lord, the Almighty Father, the everlasting God. You have surrounded us with a great cloud of witnesses in the multitude of your saints. so that we, rejoicing that we are in fellowship with them, may run with perseverance the race that is set before us. May we, together with them, receive that crown of glory that does not fade away. So with angels and archangels, with all of our companions now in the company of saints, and the saints on earth, we too praise your name. Together we say, Holy, holy, holy Saint, to the heavenly armies sing, for his glory, might, and work, fill the heavens, fill the earth. Holy, holy, holy Bride, to the Lord of hosts most high. Hail, Hosanna, David's son, blessed is the one who comes, in the name of God the Lord, name of the blessed church shall pour. Hail, Hosanna, save us now, holy, holy God, God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on that very night when he was betrayed, Jesus took the Passover bread, and when he had thanked his heavenly Father, he broke that bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this as often as you eat it, remembering me. In the same way, Jesus took the cup after the supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave that to them, saying, Drink from this, all of you, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you, for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb.
They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads.
Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. Come, join the feast.
Thank you.
thanks for the body and blood of our gracious Lord, which has fed us, forgiven us, and renewed us. Let us go forth from this place as those who would now offer everything to you, O Lord, offer everything to one another. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, the fellowship, the communion of His Holy Spirit be with you and bless you now and evermore. Amen.
Have a blessed week, everybody.